Good morning and welcome to the second meeting of 2016. Everyone present is asked to switch off mobile phones and other electronic equipment as they affect the broadcasting system. Some committee members will use tablets during the course of the meeting because we provide papers in a digital format. We have apologies this morning from Jane Baxter. Our first agenda item today is to take evidence in the Dog Fouling Fixed Penalty Scotland Order 2016. I welcome Paul Wheelhouse, Minister for Community Safety and Legal Affairs, and Douglas Forrester from the Scottish Government. After we have taken evidence on the instrument, we will debate the motion in the name of the Minister at item 2. The committee has up to 90 minutes to debate the motion, and officials are not permitted to contribute at that point. Minister, can I ask you to make any opening remarks that you may have, please?
Thank you, Convener. The order under consideration today increases the fixed penalty currently set out in Section 9 of the Dog Fouling Scotland Act 2003. The order will double the fixed penalty for dog fouling from its current level of £40 to £80, bringing it into line with the fixed penalty for littering. This change is followed on from an analysis of responses to our consultation on promoting responsible dog ownership in 2014. This consultation asked respondents to make suggestions and measures to tackle the persistent problem of dog fouling in our communities, and an overwhelming number of respondents said they would like to raise the fixed penalty. Following on from this consultation, my officials also carried out a further limited consultation among relevant stakeholders, including all local authorities and Keep Scotland Beautiful, about doubling the fixed penalty. All respondents to this consultation were in overwhelming agreement that the fixed penalty should be raised, and £80 was an appropriate level at which to set it. And that's all I have to open with, Convener, but I'm happy to take questions.
Thank you, Minister. Are there any questions? John Wilson, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. As you're aware, and no puns if they come out intended in terms of this discussion and questions, the reality is we know that it's a serious issue out there. It's one of the most common complaints that we receive. When you consulted the local authorities, 32 local authorities, could you indicate how many of those local authorities indicated that they had enforcement officers or dog wardens operating to carry out enforcement? Because there's no point in increasing fines if there is no one there to actually enforce the legislation. So could you give an indication how many local authorities indicated they had enforcement officers and the level of enforcement that's taking place since the legislation came into place?
Minister.
Well, it's certainly, I agree with Mr. Wilson that it's an extremely important point that, you know, there's little threat of prosecution or charge if there are no means to catch those who are guilty of such offences. We have been doing an exercise where we've been inviting all local authorities to tell us one by one what approaches they take at a local level to enforcement. It does vary hugely across the country in terms of the type of approach that's taken by individual local authorities to how they actually catch individuals. Some do have dog wardens, some don't, and use other officers, perhaps sort of neighbourhood officers who are doing other functions to also cover areas like dog fouling. My colleague Douglas Forrester has been involved in that exercise, and if, with your permission, Convener, I maybe ask Mr. Forrester just to comment on any evidence we've received to date. I've not yet seen a comprehensive analysis of the feedback, but Mr. Forrester may be able to contribute to that point.
Mr. Forrester, please.
Thank you and good morning. We consulted with local authorities. The Dog Fouling Act allows local authorities to use appointed officers to collect fixed penalties. As the Minister says, they might not always be specialist dog wardens. They're sometimes community wardens or neighbourhood officers, but they are authorised by the local authority under the provisions of the Act to collect those fixed penalties. I attend meetings with the Antisocial Behaviour Officers Forum. It's a meeting which involves antisocial behaviour officers coordinators at local authorities, and they've raised the issue of dog fouling, and all local authorities at those meetings say they have got authorised officers in place, and it's through those meetings that I've heard the desire to see the dog fouling campaign, the dog fouling fixed penalty to be increased. Also, there's a number of councillors from various local authorities, especially from Edinburgh and Scottish Borders, who've written in specifically asking the Minister if the Scottish Government will consider increasing the fixed penalty. So we've taken the views of these people on board, and that's why we're here today to discuss this.
Thank you, John.
Could you remind me where a fixed penalty is applied? Who receives the penalty fees?
The local authority that issues a fixed penalty, the fee is accruable to that local authority.
So in terms of the increase in the fine, would that be seen to help alleviate some of the costs? Because in terms of the assessment that's made by the government in relation to this amendment to the bill, it's said it would be effectively cost neutral and there's no additional cost to local authorities. If there's no additional cost, so the additional fees will then go to the local authority.
That's right.
Is that in the hope that we'll actually get more money into the system to allow more enforcement officers to actually carry out those duties?
That would be the aim. It's to allow the reason is it's that to allow local authorities to collect more money to invest in tackling dog fouling.
I think the other thing to bear in mind, if I may, Convener, is just to stress the importance of the signal. There has been an inconsistency in approach that's been taken to date with, in my view, slightly absurd position that if someone is to pick up their dog fouling mess and put it in a bag and then leave that bag hanging, then that's the littering fine is applicable. But if they leave the dog fouling mess on the ground and do nothing with it, they paid a smaller penalty. But both are equally unacceptable, and we're removing that inconsistency. So it's an important signal, increasing the fine, that this is an issue that society takes seriously, local government takes seriously. It does make it easier because there are significant costs involved in recovering unpaid charges, but increasing the fine therefore improves the return for pursuing the unpaid penalty and makes it more affordable to do so from the local authorities' point of view as well, so they can be sure to cover their costs in terms of recovery. And that's indeed an area that, while we haven't addressed in this measure, that would require primary legislation to do anything to improve that process to ensure that unpaid fines are paid. But that's something that could be looked at after dissolution by the current Scottish Government or indeed any other administration.
I welcome John. The Minister's comments regarding the unpaid fines and the pursuance of unpaid fines, because, as I said at the start, there's no point in bringing in legislation and fines if people then don't pay them. I also welcome the acknowledgement that's been raised with me by the members of the NFU in relation to dog fouling in the countryside, where there is one infamous tree that is littered with plastic bags containing the remains of the dog fouling that's taking place in the countryside. So there is, hopefully we can, through this, move forward and get more enforcement and make people understand they have responsibilities and duties to not them only their own dog ownership responsibility, but also to the other people in the countryside.
I wholeheartedly agree, Convener, with that point. And indeed, I know NFUS and Keep Scotland Beautiful have been working closely together to try and tackle dog fouling in agricultural areas. The legislation as it stands does not cover dog fouling on agricultural land itself, for practical reasons to do with shepherds and obviously dogs that are used, working dogs that are used in the countryside, so they are not covered by legislation. But we are conscious that NFUS and Keep Scotland Beautiful and other campaigners are keen to see this particular issue tackled, because it can, as I'm sure Mr. Wilson and others would appreciate, it can have an impact on wildlife as well. I know certainly in the Loch Lomond area, when I was formerly responsible for looking after Loch Lomond National Park on behalf of the government, that there were significant issues on how dog fouling had impacted on wildlife in that area, particularly capercaillie, and it can have a devastating impact on nesting areas. So I think there's a number of reasons, not least public health concerns for children, particularly who are vulnerable to diseases that can be caused by contact with dog mess, that this needs to be tackled. And I hope this is a small but important step in stepping up the level of response to what is widely perceived to be a significant problem.
Thank you.
Willie Coffey, please. Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Minister. If this is passed, it comes into force on the 1st of April, I see, which is only a matter of, 10 weeks away. How are we making sure that the public are aware that this is coming and our local councils getting geared up for this in terms of their awareness campaigns? And is there any evidence that they're actually beginning to provide more dogfouling bins, which many of the public always seem to be asking for more of?
Well, certainly recognise that the provision of dogfouling bins is very important. It's obviously a matter for local authorities as to how best they deploy those resources. But yes, we are confident local authorities have been in touch with officials to advise officials that they are in process of organising the new fixed penalty books that we required. They are aware that this is happening and, as has been indicated, very supportive of what we are doing. On the back, if this measure is passed today, obviously the government will use usual media channels to try and communicate that message out, and we can look to see if we can remind people near the date in the 1st of April that this is coming into force, just to, as a reminder that the legislation has changed and they are liable for a larger fine. So I do agree that the behavioural change can't happen unless people are aware that this is this measure has been taken, and therefore that the fine is higher than it was previously. So we need to educate individuals as to the fact that this is a larger risk now for them if they continue to ignore the warnings, that they will receive a larger fine. But we are confident local authorities are aware of it and supportive of it, and will do what is necessary to make sure the measure is successfully implemented.
Sorry, could I just add? So I could just add that some local authorities have already been in touch with me to ask about the fixed penalty, whether it would be coming into force on the 1st of April, because they are in the process currently of organising new fixed penalty books. So I can confirm that some local authorities have been in touch and they are already making arrangements in anticipation of this order going through.
Thank you. No, that's fine.
I have noticed, and certainly in the papers and my neck of the woods, that there seems to be some publicity on the go on this. A city warden in Aberdeen was interviewed the other day and reported that a member of the public removed their sock to remove the offending article rather than pay the fine. Cameron Buchanan.
Morning, Minister. Just, I wondered, in France, they put in public parks, they have these bags where you pay for the bag for a dog fine. Is that an idea? And also, should there be notices in public parks that the fine has been increased? Because in my theory, enforcement is very difficult, because you tell somebody to, not to, you see their dog fouling, you tell them not to foul the dog, and they just tell you to go and see a taxidermist, basically, and nothing you can do about it. So I just wonder how the enforcement is going to work, and also, can we put notices in public parks to say that the increase is now £60? Do you think that's an idea?
£80. I should point out, to pick up an earlier point as well, that if the fine is not paid, it goes up to £100, so yeah. It reaches 50% on the sort of the maximum under this area. It could be used £200, so it goes from the current 20% up to 40%, but it rises to 50% if it's not paid on time. I do agree that publicity is important, and I certainly would be very supportive of any measures that local authorities take to advertise the change. We'll do what we can through media and other outlets to do that, but obviously the delivery of things like signage is a matter for local authorities to take, and I would hope the increased revenue, if there is increased revenue from dog penalties, will help to some extent to help pay for any additional publicity. But I appreciate that's a very simplistic analysis of how the financial mechanics may work. It may not work in practice, but I would be very supportive of any efforts local authorities take to ensure that, particularly, I think the member is right to hit on things like public parks.
That's
where children would have a hope, I would hope, have a reasonable expectation they can play in safety without having to find themselves covered in dog mess and put their risk at health. So I think that is particularly important. It's probably not practical to have signage everywhere where public and dogs mix, but certainly I think public parks and play areas, football pitches, these sort of places should be areas where we make it very clear that it's unacceptable to leave dog mess.
And would you suggest in your memorandum that notices are put up? That's really what I was trying to say for the enforcement.
Well, certainly we are trying to, as I said earlier on in my earlier remarks, gauge the degree of approaches that are taken across the country. And if we can gather evidence that signage works, that adds value
in particular authorities and take local authority views on whether that's been effective, then certainly we would communicate that to other local authorities to say this has an impact. I think we've got to try and listen to local authorities about what works at a local level, and there are some very innovative practices being taken forward. I think Douglas Forrester referred to them, but Edinburgh Council, I know, are among the most proactive in terms of tackling dog fouling of the local authorities I'm aware of anyway, and have done quite a lot of work to map where dog fouling takes place and to therefore target resources at where the offences are being committed. And obviously clearly that could identify where signage would be most appropriate, rather than having it somewhere where perhaps there's very few, if any offences, and therefore not getting a good return for the investment in the signage. Targeting that resource investment in signage at areas where you know there is a problem is probably the right way to go.
Okay.
Thank you.
My understanding is that when this legislation came to pass, that in terms of the fixed penalty notices themselves, the charge was going to be based on a percentage of a Schedule 1 fine. Am I correct in thinking that?
That's correct, yes. The Schedule 1 fine goes up to £200, and the current charge is 20% of that. We are increasing that to 40%, and indeed the late penalty, which will stay the same at £20 as it currently is, would take it up to 50% if somebody doesn't pay on time.
We are doing it this way because obviously Schedule 1 fines have not increased since this legislation was enacted, is that right?
That I couldn't answer. I don't know whether Douglas Forrester knows where that figure has changed over the time since 2003 the Act came in. But
Mr. Forrester.
I did check before I put this order through, and according to the Scottish Government website, Schedule 1 fine is still set at £200, so that's correct.
Okay, so we're increasing that percentage.
Yes, indeed, to 40% as the standard fee, but 50% if it's late payment.
It seems a long while since a Schedule 1 fine has gone up then, but that's probably a matter for another committee rather than this one. Are there any other questions? No, okay. Can I then move on to agenda item 2? And as I indicated before, this is now the formal debate on the instrument. Minister, can I ask you to speak to and to move the motion, please?
Formally moved, convener.
Any contributions from members? No. In that case, I put the question that motion S4M15229 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you very much indeed. Can I thank you, Minister, for your attendance today, and I'll suspend the meeting briefly for a changeover in witnesses.
Thank you very much, convener. Thank you.
Our next item of business is to take evidence from the Scottish Government on the Burial and Cremation Scotland Bill, and I welcome Maureen Watt, Minister for Public Health, Dr Simon Cuthbert-Kerr, Burial and Cremation Bill Team Leader, and Graham McGlashan, Principal Legal Officer from the Scottish Government. Minister, would you like to make an opening statement, please?
Yes, thank you, Convener, and thank you for the opportunity to come to the committee today to speak about the Burial and Cremation Scotland Bill. Just as a brief introduction, the bill represents a much-needed modernisation of the processes involved in burial and cremation. The bill contains wide-ranging provisions that will standardise and improve practice across Scotland. The committee will be well aware of the issues identified by Lord Bonamy's Infant Cremation Commission. Lord Bonamy made a number of recommendations to improve the processes involved in the cremation of infants, and many of these will be implemented by the bill. Many non-legislative improvements have already been introduced, and the bill will create a legislative framework that will mean that previous mistakes cannot be repeated. In particular, the bill defines ashes and sets out what may be done with ashes. The bill provides a power for ministers to prescribe forms for applying for a cremation. People who complete these forms will need to specify what they want to happen with ashes, and cremations will not be able to take place without this information. The bill also establishes a process for deciding what should be done with the remains of a pregnancy loss. This places the woman who experiences the loss at the centre of the process and requires that her options are explained to her clearly and that each decision that is made is recorded. This will bring consistency and transparency to the process. The bill will also implement recommendations made by the Burial and Cremation Review Group. Some of the group's recommendations have already been implemented in the Certification of Death Scotland Act 2011. The remaining recommendations being implemented in the bill will modernise the processes involved in burial and cremation. These include giving burial authorities clear powers about what the management of burial grounds, including requirements to ensure their safety. The bill will ensure that burial continues to be an option for future generations by allowing certain layers to be reused in tightly controlled circumstances. This will ease pressure on burial space and also help to bring closed burial grounds back into use. The bill also allows ministers to introduce inspectors for various parts of the funeral industry. I have already appointed an inspector of crematoria, and the bill allows for further inspectors to be appointed to scrutinise burial processes and funeral directors. In addition, the bill also allows ministers to introduce a licensing scheme for funeral directors. If introduced, this would address concerns about the conduct of some funeral directors, ensuring consistent best practice across the industry. Overall, the bill will provide a robust framework for burial and cremation, which will meet the needs of 21st century Scotland. And I'm happy to answer any questions the committee might have.
Thank you very much, Minister. You've talked about modernisation of the system, and I think we'll probably tease out some more on that. And of course, you've just touched upon the possible licensing of funeral directors. And one of the things which has come out during the course of our evidence sessions is high costs of funerals, not only the charges from local authorities, which are very diverse indeed, but also costs of funeral directors themselves. Modernisation of burial and cremation is the aim here, but the industry itself, the funeral director industry, does not seem to be particularly modern. In fact, it seems to be stuck in the past, and that's maybe one of the reasons why there is such high costs. How can we ensure that the bill will help reduce funeral costs from the public sector point of view and from the private sector point of view?
Well, the bill's main aim is not in relation to funeral costs. In fact, we don't believe that the bill is the right place to deal with funeral costs. Undoubtedly, as you say, convener, funeral costs are increasing, but they are made up of a wide variety of different elements, which include local authority fees and funeral director fees. And we don't think that using legislation to attempt to control this cost, these costs will necessarily address the underlying problems. As I think you know, the Scottish Government is doing other work to address funeral costs. It's reviewing the operation of the Social Fund, which is to be devolved to Scotland. And the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, Communities and Pension Rights has instigated a comprehensive review of funeral costs with a view to identifying ways to tackle funeral costs across a range of the relevant sectors. And Cabinet Secretary is publishing new information to help people plan for funerals, including advice on the likely costs and to ensure that the various options for burial and a funeral are explained to people. But I would go back to what I said initially, that this bill is not the vehicle that we think is not the vehicle for helping with funeral costs.
So how do we ensure that this bill does not lead to further rises in costs? Because during the course of evidence sessions, we've heard from particularly local authorities last week that there may be an added cost to implementing some parts of the bill.
We don't believe that the bill will necessarily lead to added costs in relation to funerals, as your witness from East Dumbartonshire demonstrated last week. There's a huge variety across local authorities in relation to the costs of layers and funeral costs and cremations generally. So, but this bill is not, as I said, in dealing with helping to reduce funeral costs. And in fact, we could see, as a result of this bill, areas where we could help increase the number of layers, for example, and thereby reduce the cost of layers.
Obviously, you've just mentioned East Dumbartonshire, which have the highest costs in the country. If memory serves me right, it was around about £2,700 or thereby. Is there any way that government itself can offer some kind of guidance on a maximum cost? Because there seems to be a huge difference in those costs, not only for burial, but also for cremation. And, you know, it was kind of suggested last week that it may well be that some local authorities, some burial authorities, no longer want to allow for burials and are trying to price themselves out of the market, if you will. So, I mean, we've got this scenario where the bill is trying to increase the amount of layers, increase the amount of burial space, brings more back into use. But at the same time, it is going to put folk off using burial grounds if they can't afford to use them. How do we get the balance right?
I think currently the balance between funerals and cremations is 60% cremations, 40% burials. But as I say, we do think the bill could have a positive effect, overall effect, on costs of funerals. For example, we intend to bring forward at stage two an amendment to require local authorities to publish all costs relating to burials and cremation. We won't do the same for funeral directors because that's some matter of consumer protection, which is still reserved. But we are still working with funeral directors and the National Association of Funeral Directors to encourage them to be more transparent about their costs and to be much more forthcoming in advising customers of the wide variety of types of funerals that they can have. And we do believe that the appointment of inspectors of funeral directors, as well as introducing a licensing scheme, may help to drive up the overall standards for funeral directors and bring, as I said, that transparency.
You've talked about the consumer protection aspects, and the committee understands that, you know, these issues remain reserved. However, is there no way circumventing consumer protection legislation but bringing something else into force that the Scottish Government could require funeral directors, for example, to have to give a cost for a very simple funeral, it could be done as part of what we are going to require in terms of the devolution of the funeral grant, for example. I'm sure there are ways and means that we can come to some possible arrangement which doesn't involve consumer protection legislation. Has that been looked at?
Well, as I said, this is not the main purpose of this bill, and we do believe that, you know, because we've been working with the funeral industry and local authorities on this subject, that we have kind of generated a need to for funeral directors to be more open and transparent, and as I already said in my previous answer, to publish the wide range of funerals that are available for people and not necessarily, direct people towards the most expensive funeral that's available. But we can obviously look at this as part of the licensing requirements in guidance on subordinate legislation.
I realise that cost is not one of the main purposes of the bill, but you know, it is something that has come up to a huge degree during the course of our evidence, and we may well come back to some of this. But I just wonder, in terms of the actual aspects of consumer protection and the reserved and matters in this regards, if Mr. McGlashan could tell us if there was a way that that we could deal with these matters in Scotland rather than bringing the Consumer Protection Act into play.
Oh, I think, as the Minister indicated, consumer protection generally is reserved in terms of Schedule 5 of the Scotland Act. I think the convener was suggesting that there was that the government placed some kind of requirement on funeral directors to publish their costs. The reservation and consumer protection also covers price indications as a reserved area, and to require funeral directors to publish their costs would, we think, fall with that reservation as well.
But regulation of funeral directors, would that be devolved or reserved?
Regulation of funeral directors, uh-huh. In terms of licensing of it would be a licensing scheme, yeah. That we'd be proposing. That would be within powers, and that's certainly what we have.
So you could put within that licensing arrangements that that funeral directors had to show a tariff.
I mean, you can certainly go away and think about it. You appreciate it's a complex area, and I can't advise, I can't give legal advice to the committee. I would need to go away and have a think about it, but we can certainly...
But I think it would be most interesting for the committee to know if a licensing regime could actually have within it an acknowledgement that funeral directors have to show a tariff in order to be licensed. If you could get back to us on that, we'd be grateful. Cameron Buchanan, please.
Thank you. Good morning, Minister. I wanted to go back to the proximity of the new crematory, the 200-yard rule. Would you tell us why you decided not to put this in the bill?
Yes, this is a difficult one, and obviously one that has raised a lot of interest. The bill doesn't replicate the existing minimum distance for crematoriums. The current minimum distance, we believe, doesn't work, and providing a minimum distance in the bill isn't the right approach. And even if the bill did contain a minimum distance, it wouldn't necessarily prevent a crematorium being granted planning permission. We believe that it's preferable that decisions about the local... about the location of crematoria and the location of buildings close to crematoria are made by the planning system. So, for example, currently the perceived wisdom is that you can't build a crematorium within 200 yards of houses. Actually, you can, but it then may not get a license to operate because houses close by can object to it. But you can currently build housing right up to the boundary of crematoria, and then, you know, what is the boundary? So we believe that rather than replicating an inefficient provision at the moment, that it's best left to the planning system.
Thank you. Would you consider reducing it maybe to 50 yards? Because it's created quite a lot of controversy, this, and a lot of correspondence as well, that people wanted a minimum, they wanted to be protected, you know, by the crematorium. Would you consider maybe it was 200 to 100 or 50?
Well, I think, as I said, we believe that it's best left to the planning system and not put in distances, because currently, as I said, distances don't work. I mean, are we protecting the kind of peaceful setting of the crematorium, or are we protecting housing, residents? You know, when the legislation was first put in place, there weren't the same protections for emissions from crematoria as they are now. They're virtually no emissions. So, you know, why was that legislation put in place in the first place? I don't know if you know in your all the research you've done, Simon.
Minister, thanks very much. We have conducted quite a lot of research into the original purpose of it, and it's certainly not clear. As the Minister's indicated, though, the fact that houses can be built right up to the perimeter of a crematorium does suggest that the original intention of the minimum distance was the protection of residents from emissions rather than any effort to try and protect the sanctity of the crematorium.
Okay, thank you very much. Yep.
Can I ask then, if the 200-yard rule is not restated, does the Scottish Government intend to provide additional statutory guidance on planning issues as they relate to crematoria?
We can certainly look at that in terms of the relation to guidance, but have we got any plans at the moment?
At the moment, no. We've had an ongoing discussion with the Scottish Government planning colleagues about this, and they tell us that, or my understanding of it at least, is that any minimum distance in another act could certainly be taken into account as a material consideration by planning authorities, but nonetheless, it wouldn't necessarily prevent planning permission being granted to a crematorium proposal which was within, you know, which technically breached a minimum distance. I think the reason for that is that planning authorities look at the specific location that the development exists in, and so if planning believed that there was no particular reason other than the minimum distance in this bill why a crematorium couldn't be built within, say, 100 yards, then they would be able to grant planning permission.
Obviously, at this moment in time, the planning review panel is looking at a number of aspects of the planning system. Is this change, proposed change, something that they're aware of, and is it something that they may look at?
Certainly that's something that we've spoken to planning colleagues about. I believe at the moment it's not something that they intend to look at, but as the Minister's indicated, that's certainly something that we could raise again with them.
It certainly seems to be something that is causing some controversy. Cameron, do you want to come back in?
Yes, I just want to come back. Would you therefore consider putting in guidelines, as I didn't quite understand, if you're going to put in guidelines for the minimum distance? Put it in the guidelines.
Well, we can certainly look at that, but we haven't had proposals to do. We haven't had proposals to do that up till now.
I think it might allay some of the fears of the people who are nearby. I follow what you say about the fact that housing. Of course, I can understand that, but I think people are very concerned that it's going to be right up to the limit, and I think a guideline would be helpful and allay some of those fears.
Yeah. Thank you, Cara Helton, please.
Thank you, Convener, and it's just building on the same point raised by Cameron. I'm quite concerned about the government's position on this issue, and obviously it sort of most of the all the witnesses that have come here supported keeping the 200 yards restriction. I've had a number of people that have contacted me concerned that, given that local authorities have got a vested interest possibly in a development going ahead, maybe because they own a building or because they own, they've got the land to sell, do you not think that it's only right that residents should have some sort of legal protection to prevent this sort of invasion of privacy near their homes? I understand that in anticipation of the bill being passed, East Lothian Council have agreed plan permission for a crematorium in Haddington, and there's one property that's just 40 yards away. And surely that's not in the interest of the residents or in the mourners that would be attending the crematorium. And I was wondering what reassurance the government can give residents who face the prospect of a crematorium in their back garden. Is this not an example of how the planning system isn't working properly and a bit possibly they need to strengthen the existing protection rather than remove it as has been planned?
Minister?
Well, the currently, of course, through the planning system, and what won't change is that you can object. And we've seen an example, I think it is in Eyemouth, of a crematorium being built within the distance and an objection being raised, and it couldn't operate. But the, as I understand it, the owners of the crematorium and the objector came to an agreement, and it now goes ahead. So the current planning system, through the current planning system, one can raise an objection, of course.
Tilton?
Yeah, but just as I still do think that the current law does need to be strengthened. Last week we heard evidence, and I can't remember who it was from, to say that we should review the plan, the 200 yards criteria, so that it works both ways, so that it applies to both existing developments and future housing developments. And I think that would possibly be something that the government should be considering. But also, you said about there's no emissions now from crematoria. So I'd be interested to hear a bit more about what assessment has been made of the risk to residents of living in close proximity to a crematorium. Can you give a concrete guarantee that there are no emissions or particular like harm, ash or things falling into people's gardens? And that's obviously a concern of local residents, so it would be good to have on the record some sort of concrete guarantee that there are no sort of health implications.
Minister, or Dr. Cuthbert-Kerr?
Thank you. I certainly can't speak to the detail of SEPA restrictions, but the crematoriums require, I think, annual inspection by SEPA in terms of emissions. And emissions over particular levels will result in crematoriums' operation being suspended if necessary, or at least the number of crematoriums cremations are able to carry out being reduced. So we believe that the existing SEPA controls are appropriate and sufficient.
It's certainly not something that's been raised by anybody during a consultation that I'm aware of.
We have recently had one letter, which I think we received last week, on this subject, specifically in the development in Haddington.
Okay. Anything else, Cara?
No, that's fine.
John Wilson, please.
Commissioner, can I stay on the 200-yard limit? Just for clarification, there has been mention of the 200-yard limit being built in, and it goes back to legislation from the early 1900s. Could we get clarification on whether or not that was legislation or that was guidance? Because if it was legislation, it should not be any residence built within 200 yards, or the crematorium should not be built within 200 yards, then does that mean that there has been breaches of the legislation that have taken place since the legislation was introduced, and that local authorities have just basically ignored the legislation that was originally introduced relating to crematoria?
My understanding, Mr. Wilson, is that it was in the Cremation Act 1902, but Simon has done an awful lot of research into this, so I'm going to hand over to him.
Thank you. The way that the Cremation Act 1902 operates is that it requires somebody to object to the operation of a cremation which is built within breach of the 200-yard limit. So it's not the case that a cremation which was built 150 yards from housing would automatically be prevented from operating. It would need essentially a person who lived in a house within that distance to make an objection. I think that's what happened in the case in the Scottish Borders recently. So in terms of whether other crematoriums have been built in breach of the legislation, I can't say, but certainly that's how it operates.
Given that current planning legislation indicates that only those who live within 20 metres of a proposed development are consulted about a planning application, in relation to this 200 yards, if people aren't aware that that currently exists in legislation in the 1902 Act, that they can object, then clearly there have been a number of breaches of that 1902 Act, mainly because people or residents were unaware of their right to object to that 200-yard limit being imposed on any new crematoria. Is that not the case?
I think it would be very useful if we could get a brief summary of the difference between the planning legislation that's involved here and the operation of crematoria as per the 1902 Act. Dr. Cuthbert-Kerr, could you maybe give us a wee summary of that?
Absolutely. So the Cremation Act 1902 says that a crematorium can't operate within 200 yards of an existing house unless it's with the consent of the owner of the house, essentially. I'm not a planning official, so I can't speak to that, but from our dialogue with planning colleagues, I understand that the planning system will look at developments within the context of a particular location and will make a decision as to whether or not that particular proposal can be granted planning permission. As I understand it, even with the 200-yard distance, which is currently in the 1902 Act, a planning authority may choose to grant planning permission to a crematorium which is, for example, 50 yards from a house, because they see no planning reason to not grant permission. In other locations, however, they may choose to refuse to grant planning permission because the particular factors of the location require a further distance, or that the planning authority believe that a particular distance isn't appropriate. As I understand it, however, that's a decision made in the planning system rather than specifically in relation to other pieces of legislation.
That's very useful, because I think some folks are maybe conflating the two pieces of legislation. John.
Convener, the reason for the conflation of the two pieces, the information that's provided before us, is we have a 1902 Act that says that crematoria should not be built within 200 yards of existing residences, and yet what we have at the present and what we have seen over the period of time since the 1902 Act is Dr. Simon Cuthbert-Kerr indicated there that planning authorities have ignored the 1902 Act and made decisions.
I think we're actually putting words in Dr. Cuthbert-Kerr's mouth here, because I think the 1902 Act, if I've got Dr. Cuthbert-Kerr right, states that a crematoria cannot be built within 200 yards of somebody's abode unless they have agreed that that would be the case. Dr. Cuthbert-Kerr, am I... Mr. McGlashan.
Of section
if you
five.
Could, please, if you could, I think sure, that would be useful.
No crematorium shall be constructed nearer to any dwelling house, nearer to any dwelling house than 200 yards, except with the consent in writing of the owner, lest he an occupier of such a house.
And yet, we've heard from Dr. Cuthbert-Kerr that planning authorities have ignored that, and despite the fact objections have been raised, objections have been raised by residents about.
I want to stop you, John, because we're getting confused here to a huge degree between the legislation that governs crematoria and the legislation of planning. And it's like a planning authority can give the go ahead, for example, for a bookmaker's shop or a pub, but it doesn't mean to say that that is going to end up licensed. And we're in the same kind of situation as regards crematoria, are we not, folks?
Yeah. I, th-
think that's yeah. right, convener, yes. yes.
So I think, you know, it's again a case where we're conflating the two, the planning system and the other operation. Mr. McGlashan, do you have any other comment there in that regard?
No, convener, no other comment.
Okay.
I think Minister. Mr. Wilson Guy got it wrong in terms of, because it's a crematorium, there has to be wider consultation in relation to the crematorium.
Now, I think this is a difficulty. If it's a difficulty for this committee sometimes in dealing with these things, it's certainly a difficulty for members of the public to understand where each piece of legislation actually fits in. And one of the things which may simplify the situation is if the two things could be joined at the hip, dealt with in tandem, so that the public out there actually know what the situation is. And I think, you know, we've got confusion here, so we're definitely going to have confusion out there. And I think it's something that you may need to reflect on. And I have to be honest and say, instead of just having discussions with planning colleagues, actually come up with solutions to try and resolve it so that we don't have the situation where there is this huge amount of confusion. John, do you want to come back in?
I think on that issue, convener, no, because I think you've clearly laid your position on that interpretation of the legislation, the 1902 Act, versus what's currently being carried out by local authorities. Can we go on to, convener, just in relation to the issue of not the crematoriums, the cemeteries, and the issue about opening up or reusing existing layers. We heard last week in evidence one local authority had carried out a survey of existing cemeteries and found that anything up to 25% of layers in particular cemeteries had not been used. Has the Scottish Government carried out any work with local authorities to find out whether or not that is a universal situation in local authority cemeteries, or is that a one-off, or are there some indications of the number of layers, unused layers, that currently exist and that haven't been used for over 25 years to 50 years?
Dr. Cuthbert-Kerr.
Thank you, convener. Yes, we've worked with burial authorities to try and, both private burial authorities and local authorities, to try and work out how many layers fall into that category, and consistently across all of them they have a high number of unused burial layers. At the moment I don't have the figures in front of me, so I can't necessarily say whether 25% is common across the whole country, but certainly there are a high number of unused layers in all burial authorities.
And so we've got in the bill layers will no longer be sold in perpetuity. Instead, they'll be sold for 25 years in the first instance, and then the owner of the layer will be given the opportunity to renew his or her ownership of the layer for the next 10 years, so that we'll have more, local authorities can have more control over layers that have been unused.
John?
Minister, you've indicated that someone could go along and purchase a layer and they would be given title to that for 25 years. Would it not be more appropriate just to have local authorities sell the layers when they are required, rather than a 25-year effective lease on a plot in a cemetery? Because it starts leading to the confusion once again that somebody has, as you've outlined, purchases it, or I'm not sure whether they would be purchasing the layer if they'd only had a lease on it for 25 years and extending the lease. So they'd be effectively, just for clarification, are we talking about a lease situation rather than a purchase situation? It's how many 10-year extensions would then be granted to someone? Because you say that we're trying to end the in perpetuity rule that currently applies, but we're effectively saying the 25 years lease, then another 10, then another 10, and how can we monitor that and make sure the appropriate use has been made?
Minister?
My understanding is that it is ownership rather than lease, so it's ownership with the right to bury there. I think you might get some kickback from the public if they were told that they couldn't prepare for their eventual death by not being able to buy a lair whenever they wanted to. But I think by putting in these renewal opportunities, then local authorities will have more control over what their burial and lair situation is. And clearly, you know, if, for example, people have moved away to another area and don't want to renew their lease, then of course their ownership of that, then of course it can be resold to someone else.
It's just the definition of ownership, Minister. I think in terms of the legislation and guidance with the legislation, we need to be clear that that ownership is only applies for initially the 25-year period. Because if we talk about ownership of a lair, then it could be confused with in continuity or for that lair. And it's just trying to make sure that we get the language right so that whoever is purchasing or, as I described it, leasing the lair, is clear that that will be, if they make a purchase in 25 years' time, they may be approached by the local authority or the cemetery operator to ask if they want to renew the ownership of that. So it is about ownership or leasing. It's just trying to get that quite clear, given that we have other pieces within the proposed bill that says that certain layers will be able to be used within, after 100 years.
Yeah. Mr. McGlashan.
Right of burial is defined in section 12.3 of the bill as a right to be buried in the lair and to determine whose remains may be buried in the lair. And then section 13.1 clearly states that right is extinguished at the end of the period of 25 years. So I think we would feel that the clarity is there already, but I mean certainly we can have a think about it.
And certainly some burial authorities have already stopped selling layers in perpetuity to allow them to better manage their burial capacity and have a better control of what the situation is within their local authority area.
As I said, it's just a clarification for anyone who is considering purchasing a layer that they realise that that does not confer ownership in perpetuity. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks. Will the coffee, please?
Well, thanks, Convener. I wonder if I could just come back to the costs issue, please. We moved kind of swiftly over from that to the 200-yard issue there, Minister. What concerns me and a number of people that have given evidence and have been in touch with us is that some local authorities, and the one in particular that we mentioned last week, are charging huge fees for lair purchase and interment, almost £3,000, I think, the figure was. And I appreciate what you said about the Cabinet Secretary's review, the social fund arrangements and so on, but I'm not so certain that though that review might lead to local authorities reducing their charges for layers. The example that you gave, I think you said the balance is 60-40 in favour of cremations and opposed to burials in Scotland, but in Eastern Barton it's 75-25, according to the person that came to give evidence last week. That tells me that people within that particular authority are struggling here and are not choosing to use the burial option because of the huge cost of it. He did say, however, that the bill could help us to increase the number of layers in Scotland, and that might lead to a reduction in the cost. But is there any more of a direct tie-in that the Scottish Government could deploy there to either guide by way of guidelines or expectation in authorities to do something about their lair charges, because
Minister,
they're getting out of hand in some authorities?
Well, my first answer would be, you know, we don't want, as a Scottish Government, to be interfering in something that is clearly a local authority right or local authority responsibility. However, I think by, for example, providing for the reuse of layers that have not been used for 100 years, we can give the local authorities the option of bringing old layers back into use in existing cemeteries, so that in itself could provide more layers. You know, obviously in areas like, I think, Ayrshire and Lanarkshire, we have a situation where local authorities would be competing with house builders for land round about towns, and you don't want a burial ground and a cemetery far away from a town, because you want people to be able to go and visit the graves of their loved ones. And that's, you know, the further out it is, the less likelihood that option is available for relatives. So we think by providing the opportunity for local authorities to reuse layers in older cemeteries, it will not only mean that they can increase the number of layers, but also that it will bring these old cemeteries into use and make them, you know, vibrant places again.
So heard, Minister, that through citizens' advice, that last year there was quite a rise. It was about a 35% increase in the number of people, you know, finding difficulty paying for funeral costs. So, in terms of the social fund review that you mentioned, are you able to give us any more information on how that might assist, or is it too early for you to make any comment on that?
As I think, as I've already said, this work isn't directly related to bill to the bill, and the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, Communities and Pensions is taking this forward. And, you know, I've read the Citizens Advice Scotland report, The Cost of Saying Goodbye, too. But we know, for example, that the current social fund is insufficient in a number of ways, and once that is devolved, then obviously the Cabinet Secretary has the option to change that fund and perhaps make it better able to meet the costs of people who are finding the cost of burials too high. So there will be hopefully the opportunity to change the social fund to improve the funeral grants once that fund is devolved.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Cameron?
Just come back to you about the Commonwealth War Graves Commission. We had a bit. Do you think they should have explicit treatment?
Do I think they should have what, sir?
Explicit treatment. The Commonwealth War Graves Commission. They came and asked if they could have special dispensation for their areas.
Yes, that's an interesting piece of part of this bill, which I hadn't been aware of before. And yes, I think it is important that we take into account what the Commonwealth War Graves Commission have said. Simon had a telephone call with them just on Monday there to go through parts of the bill that they are interested in. And I think we are considering now whether at stage two we'll lodge some amendments to provide absolute clarity about how Commonwealth graves should be managed. I hadn't realised, for example, perhaps you already do, you might have an interest in this area, Mr. Buchanan, that you know, if the Commonwealth War Graves Commission identify a grave that is occupied by someone who has fought in the wars, then they can, they have this interest and can perhaps raise a plaque to say that this person died in war or as a result of war.
And bearing in mind a lot of these are abroad, a lot of these are overseas in other cemeteries. I don't know if you'd have any.
This bill doesn't affect those overseas at all, but it may be where remains have been discovered overseas and they're repatriated.
That's what I was meaning,
That then the Commonwealth War Graves Commission. But can I say we're on the case?
Thank you.
Okay. John Wilson, please.
Just on that, Minister, because I think the Commonwealth Graves clearly raised concerns last week. And given that we are, you know, within the 100th anniversary of the First World War, and there are a number of remains lying in local cemeteries around Scotland, and whether or not we can get some assurances that where there are identified the people who have died fighting for their country, that those remains will be get to lie with being untouched in cemeteries, because if with this 100-year rule, then we are very much crossing over that line if this legislation comes through, where local authorities may decide to start opening up other layers in cemeteries, and whether or not, where there are individuals who have been interred who fought in those wars, whether or not those remains would be remain intact.
Quite clear in the bill, Mr. Wilson, that if the Commission were to raise an objection where the local authority or the burial owner were thinking of reusing layers, then that would absolutely stop the process right away.
Okay. Minister, if we can maybe move on to... record keeping. Can I ask what your view is on the role of record keeping and whether it could have wider uses, for example, genealogy, tourism, and also in recording the depth of interment to improve the potential for reuse of layers?
Well, I think our late colleague Brian Adam was very active in terms of genealogy and the family tourism, and we are certainly aware of how important record keeping, not just death certificates, but also record keeping in relation to interment is important, not only for the potential reuse of layers, but in terms of genealogical research and requiring burial and cremation authorities to maintain consistent and accurate registers will ensure that anyone who wishes to check the records for any reason will be able to do so with confidence. So hopefully we can get consistency across local authorities on this. And in the future, it may be possible to link these records with other records, and that's something that we will consider as a requirement for what information is recorded and what was developed in the future.
Which probably leads us well into Willie Coffey, if he's going to ask the
thank
same
you very
questions
much.
He's asked previously.
Thank you very much, Convener. Yeah, I have raised this before, and it's on that issue about linkage, Minister, between one set of records and another. As you probably know, there is no real direct connection between a person who's buried in a cemetery and the entry in the National Records of Scotland. You have to kind of make an educated guess that it might be one and the same person. Would that be something that we would see in terms of linking the records in the future to help for, you know, help towards issues like genealogy and so on and so forth? Because there is no connection. You would be pretty much guessing whether a person's buried, who they actually are in the National Records.
No.
Dr. Cuthbert-Kerr.
Thank you. I think that's absolutely something that we could consider. The actual data requirements for the registers under the bill have yet to be decided. So I think we could certainly look at requiring, you know, the death certification number to be included in that to make a clear, unambiguous link back to the death register.
That would be very welcome. Thank you, Convener.
Can I ask just one more thing on records? And obviously, again, back to the point of the modernisation of all of this. The draft legislation itself does not require electronic records to be retained. Why would we not be requiring electronic records? We've heard from folks over the weeks that most folk do have records in electronic format now, but why would we not have this in the bill, this requirement in the bill?
I think, Convener, that's an end point that we'd like to get to, that all our records are electronic. There are some local authorities who are better than others at digitising old records. But we didn't put this in the bill because the funeral industry is very diverse, and obviously larger companies may well be fully computerised, but the smaller family funeral director in a small town may not be. So we didn't want to make it a requirement, but obviously it's something that we would like to get to.
In terms of spelling that out, is there anything that can be put into the legislation to say that we should be fully digitised by X amount of time, rather than having to revisit this in a number of years' time, only to find that still not everything is digitised?
I think this is something that the inspector of the inspectors that we've already, as been said, appointed as an inspector of crematoria. The bill allows me to appoint, or some of my successors to appoint, further inspectors. And I think that's maybe something that the inspector will could have a role in encouraging funeral directors to move to that and to spread out best practice, if you like. And there's a subgroup of the National Committee on Infant Cremation considering the forms and records, so that if we have the same forms, then it should be easier for everybody to use them and to do them electronically.
Thank you. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee have drawn your attention to a number of points, Minister, round about the why the licensing scheme at Section 66 is provided for in subordinate legislation and not in the bill, and what are the implications that that might have in those in the industry. Do you have any comment on that point that they've made there?
Yes, we've looked at the Delegated Power and Law Reform Committee's report, and I will answer them shortly. In terms of the licensing scheme in Section 66, it is our intention that the operation of any licensing scheme that is introduced would be influenced by the recommendations of inspectors. The approach taken in the bill will mean that we're not committed to a particular model and will provide sufficient flexibility to ensure that any scheme delivers what is required based on the view of the inspectors.
And why, given the codes of practice that must be complied with by burial authorities, cremation authorities and funeral directors, are they not to be scrutinised by Parliament?
In terms of that, convener, we've accepted the point made by the DPLRC, and we intend to lodge an amendment in stage two to require any codes of practice to be approved by the Parliament before they come into force.
And the other point that they made was round about Section 70, which permits the creation of unspecified penalties and sanctions and regulation. Why have such matters not been included in the bill?
In light of their recommendations, we are considering this section again, and we may lodge an amendment at stage two on this.
Minister, can I thank you and Dr. Cuthbert-Kerr and Mr. McGlashan for your evidence today. I suspend and we move into private session.